Welcome to Doggo.jl, your home for wholesome Julia tutorials. You may think that a number is just a number, but in the coding world, the number 1 is different than the number 1.0. Even though 1 and 1.0 have the same value, to your computer, 1 and 1.0 are two different types of numbers. Specifically, 1 is an example of an integer, meaning numbers like negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, etc. And 1.0 is an example of a floating point number, meaning any number using a decimal point. One of the differences between Julia and other programming languages is that Julia offers a lot of different types of numbers that you can use. I won't be covering all of the different types of numbers available in Julia, but let's take a look at a few examples so you can get a feel for working with numbers in Julia. I'm in VS Code, and I've already created a new .jl file. And I've already launched the Julia REPL by using Alt-J, then Alt-O. Julia has a built-in function named typeof that will return the data type of a value. So by default in Julia, numbers like negative 3 are of type int 64, which is short for 64-bit integer. Int 64 is an example of a data type. And by default in Julia, numbers like 1.2 are of type float64, which is short for 64-bit floating point number. When using integers and floating point numbers, you have the option of using different bit sizes for those types. Julia offers several different bit sizes, but in this chapter, I'll focus on 64-bit numbers and 32-bit numbers for illustration purposes. The difference between 32-bit and 64-bit comes down to a trade-off between performance versus precision. 32-bit numbers require less memory. As a result, applications using 32-bit numbers will run faster. But because 32-bit numbers use less memory, they are also less precise, which may lead to errors in the long run. 64-bit numbers do require more memory, but using 64-bit numbers will allow your calculations to be more precise, making them suitable for many numeric computing and scientific computing applications. Casual users may not notice any difference between using 32-bit numbers versus using 64-bit numbers. But a situation where you may want to consider moving down from a 64-bit floating point number to a 32-bit floating point number is when you need to perform a high volume of floating point math. Some examples include creating an animation of a simulation, or training a machine learning model. Since these tasks require a high volume of floating point math, there will be a noticeable difference in speed depending on whether you use 64-bit floating point numbers versus using 32-bit floating point numbers. When declaring a new variable, you can also declare the data type of the value contained in that variable. To declare the data type for a variable, use the double colon immediately following the variable name, then immediately followed by the data type. So in this example, you're declaring a new variable named example and assigning the value 1.2 to it. At the same time, you're asserting that the value contained in this variable is a 32-bit floating point number. This will override Julia's default 64-bit floating point number designation. Now here's an interesting example of floating point math. In the human world, 0.1 plus 0.2 is 0.3. But for your computer, it's not that simple. Because your computer has a binary brain, it can only understand zeros and ones. So your computer is great when it comes to integers, but it struggles with any number between 0 and 1. To your computer, any value between 0 and 1 is just an estimate, which is why it's important to use 64-bit floating point numbers if you require precision. Speaking of values between 0 and 1, Julia also supports rational numbers, also known as fractions. So in this example, 1 divided by 3 is 0.3 repeating, which is a 64-bit floating point number. But if you use the double forward slash character, that will generate the fraction 1 over 3. You can perform basic math operations using rational numbers, just like you can with any other number. So in this example, this is 1/3 plus 1/7, which is 10 over 21. Julia also supports irrational numbers. Perhaps the most famous irrational number is pi, so the value of pi is built into Julia. To round a number, Julia provides the round function. I'll cover functions in more detail in a later chapter, but in this example, the round function contains two arguments. The first argument is the value that you want to round. And the second argument, which is separated by a semicolon, is called a keyword argument that tells Julia how many digits you want your result to be. For large numbers, you can use the underscore character to make your large numbers more readable. So in this example, both the left-hand side and the right-hand side have a value of 1 million. But it's a lot easier to see that the right-hand side is 1 million. Julia ignores the underscore character when used in a number. In addition to providing all of these different data types for numbers, Julia also provides a lot of built-in math functions for your convenience. I'll show you one example. This returns the square root of a number. Before ending this chapter, I want to revisit the chapter on basic math. Recall that 4 divided by 2 returns 2.0, which is a floating point number, instead of 2, which is an integer. That's because in Julia, the division operator always returns a floating point number. An integer plus an integer will always be an integer. An integer minus an integer will always be an integer. An integer times an integer will always be an integer. But an integer divided by an integer will sometimes be an integer and sometimes be a floating point number. Julia needs to know how much memory to allocate for the result before evaluating the code. So by default, Julia uses the worst case scenario, which is a 64-bit floating point number. For integer division, Julia provides the div function. The diff function returns the quotient of the division operation, which will always be an integer. Julia also provides a Unicode character for the div function, which you can display by using /div followed by the tab key. This operator does the same thing as the div function, and it provides the perfect segue into the next chapter. So that's the basics of using different types of numbers in Julia. In the next chapter, you'll learn how to use characters and strings in Julia.